A lot of my childhood was based on being outside, being out in the elements, playing with my friends. And I remember on the weekends, we would be all excited to wake up on a Saturday morning, jump on the boat, go fishing. Sometimes we would see dolphins jumping around, we would see manatees. As a child growing up, you hear about these things in science class and you hear about them on TV. And to actually see them, you know, with your own eyes, it amazes you so much that you just want to keep doing it over and over again.
Here in Belize, we are very much cognizant of the wealth that lies within our natural assets. Belize has a diversity of people and cultures. There is the mindset of acknowledging and recognizing how blessed we are as a country because of our natural assets.
We have the second largest barrier reef in the world. Mangroves that protect our coastline, our rainforests in some places actually hide ancient Mayan sites that are a huge tourist attraction and a reminder of our culture and our heritage here in the country.
We recognize that we're able to leverage that for economic opportunities in the late 1980s, in particular in the tourism sector. This led to a boost in coastal development to facilitate the construction of hotels that could receive visitors from all around the world.
Belize was starting to become this new attraction. There were more and more demands for coastal resources and lands.
This happened at a rapid pace and regrettably, without us as a country having a blueprint in place for how we can develop in a sustainable way that can also bolster our national economy.
And that realization, coupled with the projections for climate change that seem to get more and more dire, we recognized as a country that we need to take steps to actually safeguard our natural assets.
I first started to work at CZMEI in 2009. I was hired as the coastal planner, and my main task was to lead the development of Belize's first integrated coastal zone management plan. I believe in 1989, we had local conservationists and NGOs, government departments coming together with international partners to discuss this concept called integrated coastal zone management. I was a bit intimidated by that because there were so many persons looking to Belize in terms of paving the way in the region and the world. We wanted to have a science basis to inform the recommendations in the plan. And so it was sometime in 2010, I got to meet Mary and her team of wonderful scientists, and they got to meet marvelous scientists on our side. And we were able to sit down and discuss what it is that the Natural Capital Project does and what we needed as a country for our first integrated coastal zone management plan.
My name is Mary Ruckelshaus, and I'm the Executive Director of the Natural Capital Project at Stanford University. Natural capital means the living parts of the Earth, Earth's lands and waters and species. Those are sort of the assets from which benefits flow to people. And you can quantify those benefits in a lot of different currencies. A lot of people like to use monetary currency, so they want to put a dollar value on lobster catch or the avoided damages from a storm. But there are also other values that are sort of priceless, because sometimes people want to think about cultural and spiritual values without monetizing them at all. And what we're seeing here in Belize is that these ideas are attracting non-traditional investors who are now thinking about mangroves and coral reefs and seagrasses who would have never thought of them before. They can help with global climate commitments, protect properties on the shoreline, they can boost fisheries, and they can boost tourism revenues. Can bring together very different interests across the economy, across society, that might never think about nature, and they now realize that nature is foundational to their prosperity. When we first started working here in Belize with Chantal and her team, we were really focused on integrating the communities in that whole process. A lot of the fisher folk and people who live and work in the Keys have a lot of information that they could draw on maps. So it was a lot of data collecting, then modeling and mapping, so people would know where and how much nature's benefiting them. And we could digitize it and weave it in with our digital data. Natural capital is a scientific way to quantify how nature supports people and the economy.
Do you observe the degrading a little more on the inside towards the...
Every place is unique. So being able to create place-based, culturally grounded solutions allows the solutions to be effective and adapted.
The islands that then we could identify.
This is by totally, no, this is all gone.
So what we're trying to do here is monitoring management effectiveness by tracking how natural capital, like mangroves, coral reef, seagrass beds, change over time as a function of human activities, but also how the benefits that they provide to people also change over time.
Yeah. Was filled with mangroves as kids growing up, but now it's partial, like just small patches. They cut out big portions of it.
This satellite maps.
If you ask the ordinary Belizean what the value is of the reef, intrinsically it's through the roof. There is no value, it's priceless. So being able to objectively say, based on this information, there is a monetary value and the activities that you do hand actually affect this value going forward. It really does make you take a step to actually holding something dear to the country as an asset that could help us move forward into the future.
That we're able to have here with the Belizeans is that they now have a roadmap that is the foundation for a bright future and their prosperity. Belize is probably a gold standard example, but Barbados and Bahamas, other countries across the Caribbean, completely recognize the value of their natural capital for their climate resilience and their blue economies that they're trying to grow. These ideas are spreading and being taken up. So the natural capital assessment that we embedded in the integrated coastal zone management plan demonstrate that you can balance economic, social, and conservation goals
we're seeing a lot of interest in other sectors for those kind of approaches, such as managing watersheds and forests and adapting to climate, so they can be empowered in managing natural capital for the sake of people and for prosperity.
Only through understanding the value of natural capital can we ensure that we will be doing what is necessary to safeguard nature and to truly have a thriving economy. We are capable of finding these homegrown solutions to meeting our financing gap for climate and nature, and by extension, people.
Had it not been for the work that we've done with the Natural Capital Project, your country would not be in the good position it is currently in to then build on that foundation. They helped us to visualize what was potentially at stake for us to lose if we did not have certain management practices and policies in place.
When it comes to the future of the country, I feel a bit more optimistic now that the country is taking steps towards ensuring that these services that I benefited from when I was a kid, my children and future generations of Belize could still enjoy, and being a part of that is fulfilling for me.
I think I'd love to see what we do blossom in every country around the world. Because ultimately, we're all passing through. And we need to think not only about us now, but we need to think about our children and what kind of life is waiting for them.